Hi, I'm Julio Elizalde, Artistic Director of the Olympic Music Festival, and welcome to the 2020 Virtual Salon Concerts. Now, last February, we had everything in place for the 2020 season. We had artists, we had programs, we had all of our dates reserved here in Port Townsend, and come March, all of that became extremely uncertain. And I have to thank the board of directors and the staff here at the Olympic Music Festival who made this possible. As time went on and month after month passed, we were dealing with some really unprecedented uncertainty about whether performing concerts at all would be safe. But we had a binary choice. The choice was either to stop the music completely and go silent for the summer, or to do whatever we could to produce music for our community. And thanks to the generosity of a number of donors, and thanks to some very special people who have really gone above and beyond to make this happen, we're so happy to present this digital season that you can enjoy from the safety and the comfort of your home. This summer, the 2020 Virtual Salon Concerts will be made up of a number of elements. One of them is our Rewind Concerts at the beginning. So we're going to have 2 weeks of encore performances from 2019 that were filmed with an audience. But also, we're going to have brand new performances. We're filming them in Port Townsend, in the beautiful home of some incredibly generous people. We're very fortunate to have this piano right here, thanks to the wonderful folks over at Classic Pianos in Bellevue, who were so generous to let us use this 9-foot Yamaha CFX, one of my favorite pianos to play on. And we're going to be filming these performances with violinist Stella Chen. She's the winner of the 2019 Queen Elizabeth competition in Belgium. And also my dear friend Matthew Zalkind, cellist, who is the artistic director of the Denver Chamber Music Festival. Now, these performances will center around Beethoven. This year is 250 years since Beethoven's birth, and the entire music world was scheduled to put on so much Beethoven, and it obviously so much of it is not happening, but I wanted to ensure that we shine a spotlight on his life and his music and the way it changed classical music as a whole. So you can look forward to hearing those performances. Another thing that's new this season is we're including these talks, basically educational discussions where I can get a little deeper behind the music and you can learn some more about the composer, about the compositions that you're going to hear. And also, I'll be answering some questions from viewers. So make sure you go to our website, olympicmusicfestival.org, and you can go under any particular discussion and you can submit a question that might be relevant to the upcoming performance that follows it. The performance you're about to hear was filmed in 2019 at Fort Worden State Park in the Wheeler Theater, and it's a mixture of festival artists and the Olympic Chamber Music Fellows. Now, the Olympic Chamber Music Fellowship is a program that I designed 5 years ago because I felt that there was a missing link between the summer music festivals, where you get to play with some extraordinarily talented people and some veteran artists, and the professional world. There seemed to be this missing step. And so I designed this program to serve as a stepping stone where a small group of young, really gifted players who are embarking on their career can come for 2 weeks, be part of this residency, and work alongside basically people not that much older than them, but who are completely established in the chamber music world. And we do this for two reasons. One is it really doesn't dawn on you what's missing until you're next to someone who is completely comfortable with their craft. And being near someone like that can be more instructive than taking a lesson. Now, the other thing is that we get to go into depth about things about the career, about how you negotiate a contract, how you do your taxes as a musician, how you negotiate with a university if you get a professorship. These are things that are never discussed when you're in school, but we think they're important, and so we try to enable these young players with as much knowledge as possible so that they can go out and be successful in the career, which I trust all of them will. The first piece on this program is by Claude Debussy, and it is his Petite Suite for piano, four hands. And Debussy, at this stage in his life, was still coming out of French Romanticism. The music is elegant and beautiful. Piano forehand writing is challenging. My former piano teacher, Paul Hirsch, who many of you know, always said that playing chamber music with piano forehands is in some ways the most difficult for coordination because compared to strings on a piano, the sound is immediate. The moment you depress a key, it just goes down. And so, in order to make sure that everything goes down perfectly in a unified way between two people, can take time and it can take a lot of patience. And also, when you're sharing the same keyboard, you have to come up with some kind of unusual solutions to situations where perhaps the composer wasn't totally considering the physical limitations of two hands being very close to each other. This is a delightful, delightful piece. And I hope you enjoy it. I hope you enjoyed that performance of Debussy's Petite Suite with myself at the piano and Chelsea Wang. This summer, the Olympic Music Festival is operating at a disadvantage. Usually we can count on ticket sales, which make up a very large part of our budget to carry us into the fall and winter and then eventually into our next season. Those ticket sales are not happening this year, and we need your help. This year, we're going to have a special summer fundraising drive, and it's an 88-key fundraiser. We need to raise $88,000, $1,000 per key on the piano, so that we can make sure that we can operate without any interruption into the fall, winter, and hopefully into next year, when we hope that concerts will be made available. Although we can't be together, we felt very strongly that it was important to produce these performances for free. A lot of people are going through some very difficult times in so many different ways. And we didn't want this music, which is so beautiful, to be behind a paywall. We didn't want to force people to pay for it. We wanted people to be able to enjoy it anywhere. And so we hope you will share news of this music with your friends and family here in the United States and all over the world. And the performances will be available after their premiere on our website to the end of September. And in particular, all of us at the Olympic Music Festival want to dedicate this virtual season to the medical workers. The medical workers in the Puget Sound area, in the Pacific Northwest, in the United States, and all around the world. The people who are selflessly putting themselves at risk every day to help those that are suffering from COVID-19. We want to express our gratitude to them because they're really changing the world, and we hope that this music helps to make their day a little bit better. So please join us this summer. We hope you'll consider making a donation at our website, olympicmusicfestival.org. We can use all the help we can get to make sure that we can proceed forward into the fall, the winter, and then hopefully when we can come back together in person in 2021. Thank you. The second piece on this program is by the Belgian composer, César Franck. Now, Franck was an organist, and I think he was kind of disliked by French composers because a lot of his stylistic choices seem to be aligned with Wagner. And Wagner, Richard Wagner, the great opera composer, was a controversial person in the 19th century and very polarizing, and a lot of people would pick sides and say either his music was the coming of the future or absolute garbage. And if you were on the wrong side of whoever was in front of you, they would really criticize you for thinking whatever you thought about Wagner. César Franck's music is generally very passionate and beautiful, but this piece is violent. It is stormy. It is at times obsessive. We believe that this piece was actually written about one of Franck's students. And it seems that a number of different people at the conservatory were enamored with this woman, and so much so that Franck's wife, when she was asked about the piece, it was very obvious that she hated it. And the premiere of the piece was a very infamous moment. There was a National Society of French Composers, and they would have premieres of pieces. And there was one rule, which was any piece that was premiered could only be performed once, with no additional performances or repetitions. And Camille Saint-Saëns, another famous composer, was the dedicatee of the piece, and he had agreed to perform the piece at the piano with a string quartet. And it seems that the performance was a real shock because Saint-Saëns had walked in, and Saint-Saëns was older and considered in many ways to be kind of a guardian or custodian of the high French Romantic style. And he expected this piece to flop. He expected the piece to absolutely be a failure. And the performance completed, and the audience, which was filled with composers, went wild. They went crazy, and they couldn't believe what they had heard. It was a transformative moment in French chamber music. It seems that Saint-Saëns was so offended by the reaction that he saw, being conservative as he was about composition, that he stormed off and left the score on the piano. And we don't know actually if Saint-Saëns and Franck ever found a way forward as friends. Beyond that issue that arose between those two composers, the piece was performed a number of times. They broke the rule because so many composers were fascinated by this piece. I think if you sit down and listen, you'll hear why. Enjoy the performance.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Final piece on today's program is by Gabrielle Fauré. Now, this piece is very dear to my heart because I wrote my doctoral dissertation about it at Juilliard in New York. And I remember when I was younger, I had a disc of the two Fauré piano quartets. And the first quartet is famous. It is a classic, a warhorse that's played all the time in chamber music festivals. And, you know, I would listen to the disc, I would listen to that piece, and I would rarely go past it. I would get to the fourth movement, finish the first quartet, and I'd say, time to go do something else, or time to listen to something else. And I remember one day, I was on a long drive, and I had nothing better to do, and I thought, you know what, I've never heard the second piano quartet. I should at least get to hear it once. So I let the CD continue. And I was shocked. I almost fell off my chair. The second piano quartet is unlike anything that came before it. And in some ways, I don't think any composer really wrote anything like that afterwards. It is a tour de force as a compositional exercise. I think it's very much influenced by Franck's piano quintet. You'll hear, for example, in the opening, Franck has this violent string quartet opening that's very, very shocking. And I think Fauré tried to mimic that in a way with a wave of sonority from the piano where the strings ride that sonority and produce this very, very passionate theme. The work is in four movements. The first movement is passionate, but at the same time, the second theme is very innocent, very delicate. But the writing of the music is so intricate, and there are so many tender moments. And I remember when I was rehearsing this piece with this group, we were in awe of the compositional mastery that Fauré shows in this piece. And I think every movement is worth listening to. It's beautiful, brilliant, virtuosic, at times even orchestral writing. And I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for being with us tonight. Please let us know what you think. Please let us know what you think we could do better. But we hope you'll join us for our discussion on Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific for basically just a discussion of the upcoming concert. And don't forget to submit your questions at olympicmusicfestival.org. You'll see in the event section there are little buttons to submit a question, and we would love to entertain any question that you might have, and we'll include it during the discussion. So thank you for going back with us to 2019 this year, and we hope you have a good night.